Hello friends, today we will start chapter Lagrange's formulation. In this chapter we will learn equation of motion of a particle.
On this question may be asked, derive the equation of path of the particle or show that equation of the path of the particle represents parabola. Suppose a particle is fixed. Suppose a particle is fired from a fixed point with initial velocity u bar. Not exactly vertical. But making an angle alpha with the horizontal. Suppose this is a coordinate system. Origin is a fixed point. This is a horizontal axis and this is a vertical axis. A particle is fired from this point P, O. The particle is fired from this point O with initial velocity u bar and making an angle alpha. But as acceleration force, that is acceleration due to gravity applied on this force, the path of the particle is not the straight line. It will be like this, and after some time particle falls on the ground. Now we can describe this motion of the particle or system of particles with the help of coordinates. Suppose P is any point on this particle, on this path, and whose coordinates are xy. Suppose P is any point on the path of the particle having coordinates xy. Further, we know that only gravitational force is applied on this particle at this point. Further, we know that only gravitational force is applying or acting on this particle which is acting in downward direction. So we shall resolve the force acting at this point vertically. We can write the equation of motion from the Newton's second law as x double dot equal to 0, as no horizontal force is applying on this, y double dot equal to minus gt plus c2. X double dot equal to 0 and y double dot equal to minus g. This is the first equation. If we integrate this, we will get x dot, derivative of x double dot is x, integration of x double dot is x dot equal to c1 and y dot equal to minus gt plus c2. To find out arbitrary constants c1 and c2, we use initial condition. We get c1 equal to u cos alpha and c2 equal to u sin alpha. Therefore, equation 2, we will get x dot equal to c1, c1 is u cos alpha, therefore x dot is u cos alpha, and y dot is minus gt plus c2, and c2 is u sin alpha, therefore y dot is minus gt plus u sin alpha. Equation second, where u bar is initial velocity of the particle when time t is 0. Now, integrating second equation, we get x equal to ut cos alpha plus c3 and y equal to ut sin alpha minus 1 by 2 gt square plus c4. By using initial conditions, we get c3 equal to 0 and c4 equal to 0. Thus, we get x equal to ut cos alpha and y equal to ut sin alpha minus 1 by 2 gt square. This is equation 3. Equation 2 determines velocity of the particle And equation 3 determines the position of the particle at time t. Now, from equation 3, if we eliminate t, we have t equal to u by t equal to x by u cos alpha. T equal to x by u cos alpha. And substituting this value in y equal to u by into x by u cos alpha into sin alpha minus 1 by 2 g into t square. T square is nothing but x square by u square cos square alpha. And that is nothing but y equal to u get cancelled, x into sin alpha by cos alpha is tan alpha minus 1 by 2 g by u square cos square alpha into x square. This is the equation of the path of the particle. And from equation 4, we can see that it represents parabola. Now, we shall see some notes and their explanations. Our first note is, only two independent coordinates can use for description of motion of the particle. We can explain this note as follows. The coordinates used to describe the motion of a particle or system of particle must be linearly independent. If they are not linearly independent, then the number of equations are less than the number of variables, and in this case we cannot obtain unique solution. For example, if the particle moves freely, in three-dimensional space then the three coordinates are required to describe the motion of the particle. They may be x, y, z, that is Cartesian coordinate, or r, theta, phi, that are spherical polar coordinates. But we know that the particle is moving along a curve in three-dimensional space. All the three coordinates are not independent. These are related by equation of curve, and hence out of the three coordinates one coordinate is dependent on the other two coordinates. And this shows that only two independent coordinates can be used to describe the motion. Our second note is only one coordinate is used to describe the motion of a particle moving along coordinate axis. To explain this, we know that along the coordinate axis only one coordinate is varying and other is remaining constant. Suppose if the particle moves along x-axis, then its y-coordinate is always zero and only x-coordinate is varying. If the particle is moving along y-axis, then its y-coordinate is variable and x-coordinate is zero. Thus, if the particle is moving parallel to x-axis, its y-coordinate is a fixed and only x-coordinate is variable. Thus, same case for particle moving parallel to y-axis. Thus, we can say that only varying coordinates can be used to describe the motion of the particle, and hence only one coordinate is used to describe the motion of the particle along coordinate axis or parallel to coordinate axis. Now we will discuss equation of motion of a particle. For that purpose, consider a particle of mass m having position vector r bar with respect to some fixed point. If F bar is a force applied on the particle, then by Newton's, if F bar is a force applied on the particle, then by Newton's second law of motion, the equation of motion of the particle is given by F bar equal to P dot, where P is a momentum, where P bar equal to M into R dot is a linear momentum of the particle. We know that force is defined as F bar equal to mass into acceleration, that is F equal to ma. Hence, equation 1 becomes we shall replace F by ma. Ma equal to P dot, where P equal to MR dot. Equation 1 becomes MA equal to P dot equal to MR double dot. Therefore, A equal to R double dot, second derivative. Integrating this, we will get R dot equal to integration of A, that is AT plus C, where C is a constant of integration. C is a constant of integration, and which is to be determined. To determine C, we apply initial condition. When t equal to 0, the initial velocity r dot is equal to dr by dt is equal to u bar. This implies that c equal to u bar. The velocity v equal to r dot at any time t is given by v equal to u plus at. Equation number 4. Integrating equation 4, we get R equal to UT, plus 1 by 2 at square plus constant of c1, where c1 is constant of integration. At t equal to 0, initial velocity displacement r is 0. This implies that c1 equal to 0, and hence r bar equal to ut plus 1 by 2 at square. This is the equation covered by the particle at any time t. Combining the equations 4 and 5, from 4 we get t equal to v minus u by a. Put in 5, we get r equal to u into t, that is v minus u by a, plus 1 by 2 a into v minus u by a bracket square, and that is equal to u v minus u square divided by a plus 1 by 2 a. This is a square, a get cancelled. V minus u square is v square minus twice u v plus u square. Transferring 2a to the left hand side, we will get 2ar equal to twice u v minus 2 u square plus v square minus 2 u v plus v square u square. Therefore 2uv plus 2uv minus cancel, and we will get v square minus u square. Therefore v square equal to u square plus 2ar. This is the equation determining the velocity of the particle at a given distance . Equations 4, 5 and 6 are algebraic equations of motion, and they are derived from F equal to P dot, that is F bar equal to dP by dt. This is the differential equation of motion. From equation 7, we can conclude that if applied force is 0, then dp by dt equal to 0. Integrating, we get p equal to constant, and hence the linear momentum is conserved. Thus, if the applied force is zero, then the linear momentum of the particle is conserved.